Hi folks, welcome back again this week. I'd like to take a look this week at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Very interesting chapter to look at. Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by some prophecy, report or letter supposed to have come from us, saying that the day of the Lord has already come. People take what Paul wrote Thessalonians, the two books of Thessalonians. People take what Paul wrote and they pervert it. They don't understand what he's talking about. Even Peter said that Paul was hard to understand, unless the Spirit was really in a person. And they pervert it. They twist his words to make it sound as though, well, the day of the Lord has already come. No, it hasn't. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs. And the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. Now, some people might think that this man is a single individual. No. It is the number of man. It is not a single individual. It is the man of lawlessness. In other words, something has to be revealed that uncovers the lawlessness that has gone rampant. Is running rampant within mankind. It says that he will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worshipped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple. Look where he is, in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. Ooh. Sound like a lot of the things we've spoken of in the past? Man claiming to be God. All the little insinuations in the doctrines and the teachings that, well, when you look at them, they're insinuating that man is God. Oh, well, Jesus is in me and Jesus was a man, so I can be Jesus. You know, I'm the Christ. I'm bringing you the gospel message, you know. I am the power of God, you know. He says, don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you all these things? And now you know what is holding him back, so that he may be revealed at the proper time. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work. But the one who now holds it back will continue to do so till he, the one who holds it back, is taken out of the way. Oh boy, remember the tent peg? When it shears off, all the weight hanging on it? Remember who the tent peg is? It's Jesus. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will overthrow with the breath of his mouth and destroy by the splendor of his coming. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displaying all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. Well, tell me, who's the truth? For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion, so that they will believe the lie, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness instead. Now, it's important. I'm just going to down to another place here. It's speaking of the rebellion. And we have to ask ourselves, we know what the rebellion is, of course, but how do we prove that? Why do we say that the rebellion is man, claiming that man is God, forgetting that Jesus is not a man, thinking that Jesus was a man or is a man, and that we're just like Jesus? Well, we're nothing like God. Man is nothing like God. Our thoughts are not God's thoughts. Our ways are not God's ways. God may well come in and guide us through his word to understand all things, but that don't make man God. So this rebellion, let's go to in Hebrews chapter 3, start at verse 7. So as the Holy Spirit says, now don't forget the Holy Spirit is truth. As the truth says, as it's written in Scripture, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the desert. So there was a rebellion there. Well, what was their rebellion? Well, it started out, you know, quick overview or a quick recap. It started out, they doubted the power of God. God is showing them wonders, miracles beyond the capability of any man to perform. And he's delivering them out of Egypt. And they've come out of Egypt now. They're at the mountain of God, and Moses goes up onto the mountain. And he's gone for, you know, more than a month. And they don't know where he went. And they think, well, he deserted us. And what do we do, you know? And they wanted a God to serve. And you know how chatter gets, you know. Well, Moses is gone. He's not leading us. You know, he went up there and he doesn't seem to be coming back. So, you know, What have we got? Well, what does the scripture say they have? Well, it says they plundered of Egypt, of all the gold of Egypt. They're rich beyond belief. They plundered Egypt of everything. Took it all. Wow. With all this gold, we can go anywhere we want. We can do anything we want. We're rich. We have the power of money, of wealth. Wow. Aaron, this is what we should be worshiping. Well, bring this, everyone bring a ring or a, you know, an ear hoop or a bracelet, you know, something that you have. Everyone's got lots of gold. And bring it and decast, put it all together. You remember, there's 1.6 million men came out of Egypt. And that's men, grown men. And that's not including the women and children. But everyone plundered Egypt, so everyone's got lots of gold. And everyone brings a little something, you know, that they want to donate to the pot. Aaron casts it all into the fire, and out comes the golden calf. What they want to worship. The beginning of power, yes, of course, it's a calf. Of course it is. It's the beginning of power. There is power and wealth. It's not the power of God. Power of man. So this golden calf, they bowed down and worshiped that. They're dancing up a tune. Man, we are so rich. We have got the world by the tail now. We have plundered Egypt of all its wealth. We've got clothing. We've got footwear. We've got absolutely everything we need. And we've got all their gold. Do you see the golden calf? Lots of people worship the golden calf today. Oh, goodness. They think money is the be-all and end-all of God's blessings, you know. If God is really blessing you, he'll make you wealthy. You know, all the prosperity teachers and all that. They're no different than the Baals, you know, that served the golden calf. They're no different. So at this time, when they're coming out of Egypt, there is a rebellion spoken of. Do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. During the time of testing in the desert, where your fathers tested and tried me for 40 years and saw what I did. This is why I was angry with that generation, and I said, their hearts are always going astray, and they have not known my ways. Let's go and look up the words. Let me see, where is it? Daily sacrifice. D-A-I-L-Y. Sacrifice. Daniel. We start at chapter 8, verse 11. It set itself up to be as great as the prince of the host. Now, what is this it? Let's back up. Got to back up quite a few ways to find it out. It's the goat. Okay, well, what is, let's go back to verse 1. I'm sure that'll get us to where we want to start. In the third year of King Belshazzar's reign, I, Daniel, had a vision. After the vision that had already appeared to me. So now he's his second vision. But it's like the first. In my vision, I saw myself in the citadel of Susa in the province of Elam. In the vision, I was beside the Ulai Canal. I looked up, and there before me was a ram with two horns standing beside the canal. And the horns were long. One of the horns was longer than the other, but grew up later. Horns symbolize strength. So there's two strengths. This ram has two strengths. One was started out a little shorter than the other, but grew up later. They're both the same strength. Think of father and son. I watched the ram as he charged towards the west and the north and the south. Now, if the ram is charging towards the west, where's he coming from? If he's charging towards the north, and the south, and the west, where is he coming from? He's coming out of the east. Remember that. The Savior comes from the east, the ram. I have a video. What's it called? I'll have to look it up. It'll be at the end of the... At least I'll try and remember to put it at the end of the video. It has to do with the ram. No animal could stand against him. That is, against the ram. And none could rescue from his power. He did as he pleased and became great. As I was thinking about this, suddenly a goat with a prominent horn between his eyes came from the west. Well, in the west is vision. It's war. It is... If we're coming from the east, we have the vision of authority in Christ to make war against the vision of evil against Christ. So if it comes from the west, of which this goat does, He came from the west, crossing the whole earth without touching the ground. So it is spirit, isn't it? He came towards the two-horned ram I had seen standing beside the canal and charged at him with great rage. So this is the west fighting back against the east. This is the vision of man wanting to be God, fighting back against the authority of God being God over man. I saw him attack the ram furiously, striking the ram and shattering his two horns. The ram, so it shatters the strength of both father and son. The ram was powerless to stand against him, and the goat knocked him to the ground and trampled on him, and none could rescue the ram from the goat's power. The goat became very great, but at the height of his power, his large horn was broken off, and in its place four prominent horns grew up towards the four winds of heaven. Out of one of them came another horn. I'll back up. I can't leave you. I got to tell you what this is talking about. The four winds of heaven. The four winds of heaven are, of course, the four living creatures. The oxen in the north, which is maturity. The eagle in the west, which is vision. The man in the south, which is creativity. And the lion in the east, which is authority. So this single horn broke off. Whereas it's the goat. Remember the separation of the goat from the sheep. The sheep go to heaven, the goat goes to hell. Period. Not hard to understand. So it splits into four, and it starts going into the avenues of it. It's separating. It's not just the worship of falsehood, but it's the worship of falsehood with maturity, falsehood with vision, falsehood with creativity, and falsehood with authority. It's got the four living creatures going in its favor, all right, but God's not in it. Out of one of them came another horn, which started small, but grew in power to the south and to the east and towards the beautiful land. So south, east, and the beautiful land. If you want to understand that, look up the beautiful land. Find out what direction. You're going to discover that this horn is in the east. It's in authority. It grew until it reached the host of heavens, and it threw some of the starry hosts down to the earth and trampled on them. Now we're into the book of Revelation, where I saw a great red dragon, and his tail swept a third of the stars from the sky. Connect the dots. It set itself up to be as great as the prince of the host. Well, the prince of the host is the Christ. It's Jesus. It took away the daily sacrifice from him, from Jesus, and the place of his sanctuary was brought low. Oh boy, that's us. That's the temple. We're brought low. Because of rebellion, the host of the saints and the daily sacrifice were given over to it, to the goat, to falsehood. It prospered in everything it did, and truth was thrown to the ground. Truth is the Father. It's the whole idea of God, put him down, man, lift him up. God, who needs them? Who needs that? Man? Oh. Then I heard a holy one speaking, and another holy one said to him, "How long will it take for the vision to be fulfilled? The vision concerning the daily sacrifice, the rebellion that causes desolation, and the surrender of the sanctuary of the host that will be trampled underfoot." Oh, get ready. Get ready, folks. You call yourself a Christian? You call yourself a part of the temple of God? Get ready. Brace yourself. He said to me, it will be 2,300 evenings and mornings. Then the sanctuary will be re-consecrated. Now, we could go on. We're not going to go on. We're going to go back. What are we looking at? We're looking at the daily sacrifice. They take the daily sacrifice from he to whom it belongs. The daily sacrifice belongs to God. It belongs to the Prince of the Host, who is God. It belongs to the ram with the two horns the same length, Father and Son. They are one. Father is the mind of God and the heart of God, and the Son is the form of God. Within the form dwells the Father and His Spirit, truth and love. It's not us, it's Jesus. He's the Christ. We're not the Christ. Now, in thinking about, pardon me, the daily sacrifice, a person might, in not understanding everything we understand, a person might ask himself, where do you find this daily sacrifice? You look it up in the scriptures, the only place you find those words, daily sacrifice, are in the book of Daniel. So you think, well, what can I look up? Let's look up morning sacrifice, for example. This is a sacrifice that's to be given every day. Every day. So let's look up morning sacrifice. M-O-R-N-I-N-G, sacrifice. S-A-C-I-F-I-C-E. Let's see what it says. It's only two books, Deuteronomy. Job. It said, when a period of fasting had run its course, Job would send and have them purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, his children, thinking, perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. And this was Job's regular custom. So we could liken the morning sacrifice to each day. He'd have them purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering. It's something to maybe do with a burnt offering every day. What else is said? Nothing else said about that. So, okay, well, let's try to look up sacrifice each day. S-A-C-R-I-F-I-C-E, each day. Let's see what it says. Wow. Exodus 29:36. You ready? Sacrifice a bull each day as a sin offering to make atonement. Well, that fits with what Job said. He made a sacrifice each day, a burnt offering each day, in case his children had sinned. Well, that's a sacrifice of atonement, isn't it? And here it's telling us that you're to sacrifice a bull each day. Wow. Now, we know God didn't ask for the blood of bulls and goats and doves and sheep, and that's not what it's talking about. But the sacrifice of a bull, boy, it has a huge meaning. Go to Webster's Dictionary, if you will. Look up the word papal bull. You're going to find it is a declaration of truth with authority. Backed by authority. It's a declaration of truth, backed by authority. Well, that's a long way from a four-legged bovine, isn't it? And yet that is what the scriptures tell us a bull is. It says David sacrificed 10,000 bulls in one day. I'm sorry, folks, but there is not a hope in hell of one man slaughtering 10,000 bulls in one day, even if it was 24 hours, if he did it for the whole day and night period of one day. It's impossible. And yet, it's written, David sacrificed 10,000 bulls when he brought the ark up to Jerusalem. What did he sacrifice? Remember what a papal bull is? A declaration of truth backed by authority. Well, the authority is God. God speaks by his word. What do you think our daily sacrifice is supposed to be? Because I'll tell you, you don't see it very much anymore. You see people singing praises to God, whoever that is. We see people talking about Jesus. Praise Jesus. Well and good. But is that the sacrifice of the bull? Jesus is Lord, folks. I will tell you that every day for the rest of my life. I've been telling you that every day for a long, long time. Jesus is Lord. There is no other. There is but one God. There is no other God. I know not one. Jesus is who he claimed to be. Jesus is the first and the last. Jesus is the beginning and the end. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. Jesus is the Ancient of Days, having taken off his immortal form and put on mortality, come down, revealed himself, testified concerning himself, was arrested, accused, murdered, 3 days in the grave, risen from the dead and returned to the Father. Jesus alone is the Christ, and the Christ is the Messiah, and the Messiah is God the Father himself in his one and only ever begotten bodily form. Yes, we crucified God. Are you happy about that? When you see the absence of the daily sacrifice, the sacrifice of that bull, that declaration with authority, declaration of truth with authority, do you see that? You're seeing it right now from this individual. How about you? What's your testimony? What's your confession? You're not saved by what you believe. You're saved by what you confess. You're saved by faith. You're saved by understanding that righteousness that comes. We spoke about what? Last week? 2 weeks ago? Righteousness that is by faith. That if you confess that Jesus is Lord, what does that mean, to confess that Jesus is Lord? It means to acknowledge that Jesus is God himself in flesh. That our salvation is not something we of ourselves. Our salvation is of what Jesus did for us, not what we think we can do for ourselves. Our salvation comes from our testimony. Jesus is Lord. Love is what he wants. Yet will even our lack of love at times prevent God from being faithful to his promise that all who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved? No, God is faithful. God is faithful. Even your lack of loving one another once in a while will not prevent you from losing your salvation. But your lack of loving God? Oh boy, yeah, that'll prevent you. You think you're God? You're not. Neither am I. But Jesus is. Who do we point at? Do we point at ourselves, at our behavior? Do we point at others and others' behaviors? Do we point at law? Do we point at money? Do we point at prosperity? Do we point at good health? Do we point at our positions among men? Or do we point at Jesus? Come, crucified, risen from the dead, and returned to the throne of authority which is his and his alone. Do we puff ourselves up as I'm sitting on the throne with God? Or do we lower ourselves and say, thank you, Lord, for coming in to save me? Thank you, Lord, for revealing yourself to me. What can I do for you? Oh, move over, fat ass. I want to sit here with the throne with you. Or what can I do for you, Lord? What can I do for you? Things to think about, aren't they? Things to think about. When you see the abomination that causes desolation standing in the temple where it does not belong, it's talking about the temple of God, where it does not belong. All the things men want to praise. You praise music? Is music your God? Oh, come on out for a sing-song, Ed. It's so great. Oh, you'll feel so good. I say shove your music up your ass. The same as God said the same thing in his book. He doesn't want to listen to your music. He wants to hear the confession that he asked come forth from our lips. Oh, but Ed, I do believe Jesus is Lord. What else do I do? Daily. It's a daily sacrifice. It's not once in your life and, oh, yeah, I believe that. Yeah, and I won't say anything else ever again. That's not a daily sacrifice. It's a daily sacrifice. When you wake up in the morning, what do you say? Ugh. Shit, it's raining again. Or thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for another day. Thank you for another breath. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to have another, how many hours to serve you? When a servant is working in the field with his master, and he comes home, does the servant say to the master, feed me? No. The servant has the master sit down, and the servant prepares a meal for his master. And when his master has finished eating, the master will tell him when it's time for him to sit down and eat. The servant serves the master. The master does not serve the servant. If you're the servant, why the hell do you want to behave as though you're the master? something about, isn't it? Is it the hockey game that's the most important thing to be on our lips every day? The football game? Oh, how about the election? Oh boy, we gotta talk about that horse shit, don't we? How about criticizing our leaders? Oh yeah, that's choice morsels, isn't it? What is it that consumes us? What God do we serve? Do we want to talk about God and His Christ? Is that our motivation? Or is our motivation criticism, contempt, gossip, slander, vindictiveness, violence, music? Health. Oh, got to start the day off right. Ooh, 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 ooh. Get out there and exercise, run our quarter mile, you know. Is that what occupies your mind and heart? Or does the message of God and His Christ occupy your mind and heart? I don't know. It's up to you. I guess you're going to worship whatever you want to worship. Are my videos too long? People go on the internet, man, I'm telling you, I watch the, you know, the big hitters on YouTube, and they'll get 2.5 million views in like 24 hours. And it's some pervert dressing up in the opposite sex's clothes, painting himself all up and everything like a little girl. And you think, wow, where's people's minds and hearts? They want to watch that. Oh, that's something, you know. The cooking shows, the soap operas, the makeup shows. Oh, yeah, that's important. What some clown in Hollywood is doing? Perversion, debauchery, whoredom. Oh, that's interesting. Oh, yeah, I want to watch that. You think that the abomination that causes desolation is more or less taking over the temple? I do. Even the Christians don't want to watch. They don't want to look into the secrets of God. They don't want to look into the Bible. Oh, great, if there's some guy on there saying, you know, like, oh, I got the power of God in my right hand. I'm going to lay my hands on you and touch you. Someone out there has Parrot's disease. God told me. Good grief, man. You couldn't be more full of shit than a toilet. What's on people's minds? What do people want to watch? What do they want to learn? What do they want to seek? What do they want to worship? And not the key, eh? What do they want to worship? First, it's a daily sacrifice. It's not a monthly condition. It's a daily sacrifice. Jesus is Lord. Love one another. Lord willing, we'll see you again next week. Bye.